That confirmation hearing in the Senate Armed Services Committee yesterday included a lot of questions for Air Force Secretary nominee Frank Kendall about the F-35. That's only one big decision point Kendall faces if the Senate confirms him. Lieutenant General Dave Deptula, U.S. Air Force retired, Dean of the Mitchell Institute for Aerospace Studies. He's writing about the top five action items for the next Air Force Secretary in Forbes. Dave, welcome. It's great to see you again, General. Thanks for coming on. These 5 points that you point out, whether it's Frank or somebody else, looks like it will be him, include some pretty big rocks to move. Which of these five, before we take them in turn, do you think is the most important to pay attention to?
Well, Francis, first, thanks very much for having me on this morning. If I was to prioritize these top five that I've mentioned, I believe the greatest priority should go to getting rid of the pass-through of $40 billion that is included in the Department of the Air Force accounts, but which the Department of the Air Force has absolutely zero control over. And I know it's a bit of an esoteric issue, but it is enormous in the context of how it mischaracterizes the resources that are being given to the Air Force.
You write about a concept in here also that I think is interesting, and you put it this way: advocate for the DOD to adopt and apply cost per effect force planning analysis. What's that concept mean, and why is it important, Dave?
Well, it's important because it's the best way to achieve lasting and very quick efficiencies for the Department of Defense while boosting combat capability. And that is, and let me very briefly use an example of cost per effect. Today, everyone focuses on unit cost, whether it be an aircraft, a ship, a combat ground vehicle. But what cost per effect does is it takes a look of not just individual weapon system cost, but let me give you a case. If I can accomplish a strike in a contested battle space with two fifth generation aircraft, F-22s or F-35s, that would take a force package of 15 to 20 other non-stealth aircraft, you tell me which one's the most cost effective. The answer is the F-22 or the F-35, because it doesn't take as many. That kind of a consideration in terms of what's required to achieve a mission effect is how the Department of Defense needs to consider new weapon systems in the future.
Okay, and that connects then to another item on your list for the next Air Force Secretary, which is to strongly advocate for a comprehensive and complete roles and missions review of the armed forces, not the Air Force, you write armed forces. This should be holistic across the department, it sounds like.
No, absolutely. I mean, let's be pragmatic. I mean, we all recognize, even though many of us in the defense business recognize that to meet the needs of today's national security strategy, we need about a 3 to 5% increase on an annual basis to the Department of Defense budget, but we're not going to get that. So the best thing that we could possibly do is to look across all the services and look at where there's excessive overlap. Again, not within the stovepipes of the services, but across all the services, and do some balancing to yield the best effects to make sure that we have all the mission areas covered. But there is a lot of duplication. A good case in point is the Army's going out there investing billions in building new hypersonic surface-to-surface missiles that are enormously costly, and they're not reusable. Well, you can accomplish the same thing, if not better, and in a reusable fashion by increasing the buy of B-21s, the next long-range stealthy bomber.
Another item on your list, Dave, is recapitalizing the Air Force's geriatric air combat capacity. I love that word. And completing current aircraft programs of record. I mentioned the F-35 questions to Frank at this hearing. His response, I'm paraphrasing, was we should probably buy more in order to keep the cost per unit down. He's back to cost per unit versus cost per effect. But the point is, it sounds like that staying the course is the same thing that he's thinking. Am I hearing it right?
Yeah, I think so. Now listen, cost is important, but again, in the case of the F-35, it's a double win because now it's actually on a per unit cost basis less expensive than new old fourth generation aircraft like the F-15EX, which costs more on a unit basis, but it also takes many, many more to accomplish the same mission. And you're right, we do have a geriatric Air Force. We've got bombers that are 60 years old, Francis, tankers and trainers that are over 50, and fighters that are over 30 years of age. And we the Air Force has major capacity shortfalls across all its highest mission priority areas. So the way to fix this is to stick with the programs of record that we have today, actually accelerate the F-35 buy, increase the B-21 buy, and get the C-46 online as soon as possible.
About a minute left. The last item on your list regards the Space Force. What does a mature Space Force look like? Resources, people, et cetera?
Well, Francis, I'd tell you that right now today, the Space Force is underfunded, it's undermanned, and it does not have the authorities to integrate the numerous and disparate organizations and agencies that have a hand in space to fulfill its mandate of providing trained and ready space forces to combatant commanders. To put it in perspective, the Space Force receives only 2% of the entire DoD budget. That has to change, and we need to start buying capabilities that we can actually conduct effective military operations in space and perform both offensive and defensive missions. That's going to take more money, and it's going to take a good look across the Department of Defense to determine how to appropriately fund the Space Force.
Dave, thanks very much for joining me. It's great to have you on. Appreciate your time.
You bet, Francis. Have a great day.